Yes, so thanks for the introduction. Exactly, I'm going to talk about so beta ensembles, and in particular about central limit theorem for the logarithm of the characteristic polynomial of beta ensembles. So this is the real part of the logarithm of the characteristic polynomial for this model. This is a joint work with Paul Bourgade and Krishnan Modi, which are both at Courant as well. Okay, so let's start. First, a small overview of what we're going to see. So the model will be beta ensembles that I'm going to introduce afterwards. So I, okay, for now, I just have particles on the real line. And the initial goal, so one of the initial goals was to understand the joint fluctuations of these particles around their expected positions. Okay, it's known for many models of random matrices now, but for the general beta ensembles, it was not known. One way to achieve this goal was to study actually the logarithm of the characteristic polynomial. So proving a central limit theorem for the logarithm of the characteristic polynomial, it implies this by taking the imaginary part. So I'm going to come back to this also afterwards, but that's the link between this and this. This really implies easily this part. Now, okay, how do we get this central limit theorem? The key ingredient is an optimal local law. So as often in random matrix theory, the key ingredient is about improving a local law. So okay, I'm gonna present this new way of getting a better local law for beta ensembles. And okay, as a byproduct of this local law, we also get optimal rigidity. So I won't discuss it so much, but I will just mention it. And finally, how do we get this optimal local law? By using loop equations. So, okay, there will be two parts, or actually three parts. I will first introduce beta ensembles, and then there will be two parts. I will first discuss the local law and explain the proof in terms of loop equations. Okay, we'll put this first because that's really, I would say, the main new things, the main new ideas in this paper. And then we'll explain how to, so first present our results, our fluctuations results, and then explain how to get them using the local law. Okay, so that's the plan. Okay, so first beta ensembles. Okay, I guess many of you already know what they are. So we consider particles on the real line, lambda 1 to lambda n, that are ordered. And they are all individually affected by a potential, V. And also they are interacting, and the interaction are logarithmic and repulsive. So the energy of a configuration is given by the sum over the particles of the potential applied to each particle minus the sum of the logarithm of the distance between particles. And then our measure is the Gibbs measure. For some beta, we pick a configuration at random according to the Gibbs measure. So this is the density of particles, which is which has a usual form which appears in a random matrix theory. So there are particular cases where the lambda is are eigenvalues of random matrix models. The simplest one is if you take V, which is quadratic, and beta, which is 1, 2, or 4, and you get the Gaussian classical ensembles. So, which are obtained by just taking a random matrix with ID Gaussian entries up to some symmetry. For any V, but beta equals to 1, 2, 4, you get the classical invariant ensembles. And finally, you can also take V, which is quadratic, but any beta, and that's the Gaussian beta ensembles. And for these ones, it's not so clear that they are they can be seen as a random matrix model, but that's a result by Dumitriou Edelman. That you can, in this case, you can see the lambdas as the eigenvalues of a three-diagonal random matrix. So a matrix with only random entries on the three central diagonals. Okay. So basic stuff about beta ensembles. There is a law of large numbers. So if you look at the empirical measure of the particles, it converges almost surely to an equilibrium measure that can be defined as the minimizer of this energy, which is just the limit of the Hamiltonian when n goes to infinity. This measure has a density and is compactly supported under a reasonable condition on V. Okay, so for example, for Gaussian beta ensembles, this measure is just the semicircle distribution. Okay. Please stop me at any time if you have a question. Okay, what are our assumptions? First, we assume to be in the one-cut regime. So this means that the equilibrium measure, we know that the support is compact, but we assume that it's a single interval. And the second assumption is that, okay, it's called that V is not critical. And it means that the density behaves as a square root close to the edge, on both edges. So exactly the same behavior as the semicircle distribution. And then we have, so that's really, I think, required for our methods. So maybe one cut we could get rid of it, of critical, that's really different stuff. Then we have more technical assumptions. First, to assume that V is analytic on the real line. And then we just have assumptions on the growth of V and V prime. So one example which works, for example, is any convex function which grows slower than exponential x squared at infinity. And that still grows to infinity, yes. this is enough, for example. Okay. So that's it for the model and the assumptions. Okay, so let's talk about the local law. So what is a local law? We look at the Stieltjes transform of our empirical measure. So it's the 1 over n times the sum over all particles of 1 over lambda k minus z. And then we also look at the Stieltjes transform, but of the equilibrium measure, which is this function of z. Then the law of large numbers tells us that S of Z converges to S of equilibrium of Z at any fixed point Z. But now, okay, a local law, the goal of a local law is to prove that even in intervals that are whose length is going to zero when n goes to infinity, there is the right number of particles, and one way of doing it is to control the Stieltjes transform, but at low levels. So we want to estimate the difference between S and S equilibrium, but at a level which is eta, so but eta goes to zero when n goes to infinity. And the theory, so the optimal thing that we can expect is that the difference will be of order 1 over n eta. And just because only the particle which is the one below z contributes as 1 over n eta. So that's what you expect. Okay, so here are just some pictures of what is going on. So I will reduce eta, and you'll see that the two curves are so the orange curve is fluctuating more and more, and so it's just that you approach the axis, and so the singularities are worse and worse. So in the end, you get this. When eta is equal exactly to n minus 1, the fluctuations are of order 1, and you see there is no convergence anymore. Okay, so that's the goal. The goal is to prove that S minus S equilibrium is of order 1 over n eta. So what was known before is the following results. The difference between S and S equilibrium for any epsilon, it will be smaller than n epsilon over n eta with overwhelming probability. So that was a result by Bourgade-Erdős-Chiron. There was a weaker local law proved by Soso and Wong as well. Okay, our goal is really to get rid of this n to the epsilon, because with this n to the epsilon, we cannot get the fluctuations that we want later. So here is the result. It's not in terms of overwhelming probability, but in terms of moments. There is a neighborhood of AB, so of the spectrum, such that for any point in this neighborhood, uniformly, for any Q, the Q's moment of the difference is smaller than a constant over n eta to the cube. So it really tells that this is of order 1 over n eta. So this constant CQ, okay, I don't write it. Actually, there are several regimes and so on, but okay, it's important. The value is actually important concluding things. I mean, if this constant is too large in terms of Q, it's not possible to use very high moment efficiently. So the value matters a lot, but okay, I won't enter these details, except if some of you have some questions about it. So as I mentioned, we can deduce rigidity from this. So the fact that with overwhelming probability, no particle moves from its expected position of a distance more than large constant times log n over n. And this is the optimal scale for rigidity. So the previous result, which was known, was n to the epsilon over n. And it was by Bourgade-Erdős-Chiron. okay, it's not a direct consequence. Okay, it's a direct consequence from this to get, I don't know, log n to the 100 over n. But actually, getting this is requires a bit of work, but I won't discuss the rigidity more than that. Okay. And finally, I wanted to mention that such sharp local laws have been proved as well for Wigner matrices, so by Cacciapuoti, Maltsev, Schlein, and then it has been improved by Gutson, Nomov, Tikhon, Mirov, Timoshev. So the improvement is about improving the constant CQ, and again, it matters a lot actually to improve this constant. Okay, excuse questions?
Me. Yeah. Yeah. So the result that you are showing, does it hold in the bulk or also at the edge?
Also at the edge. Okay. So there is really a whole neighborhood around the AB, but also on the side, everywhere around, on the complex plane, where I have this inequality. It's just that, yes?
The scaling in n doesn't depend on whether you are at the edge or...
No, that's okay. So, no. okay, I see why it can be surprising, but... okay, why is the scale at the edge larger than So how can you find, so the typical distance between particles is 1 over n in the bulk and 1 over, so n to the minus 2 third at the edge. How can you find the n to the minus 2 third with this? It's about when can you find the leading order? When does this inequality identify the leading order of S? And S equilibrium, okay, not of S actually, but of, okay, sorry, I should think a bit more about my explanation. Okay, yes, about the imaginary part of S equilibrium, at least. Okay, don't see if it's, which is really the good tool to control the number of particles that are below Z. The imaginary part decreases close to the edge and goes to zero as a square root of the distance to the edge. And because of this, you can identify the leading order only if eta is of order n to the minus two thirds. And okay, it's kind of, okay, there is no contradiction here at the edge. Okay, I don't know if it answers the question. But.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. So let me present the proof of these results. So that's really the main new thing, which could be really of independent interest for other models. So it relies on loop equations. So I will present the proof in the case of Gaussian beta ensembles. I'll explain at the end why it was simpler in this case. So we look at the Stieglitz transform, the equilibrium Stieglitz transform, and it satisfies the quadratic equation. So for Gaussian beta ensembles, it's an explicit function, which and you can check that it satisfies this equation. But there is always a quadratic equation satisfied by the Stieglitz transform at the equilibrium. And the goal, which is widely used in random matrix theory, instead of proving that S minus S equilibrium is small, we prove that if you replace S equilibrium by S in this polynomial, you get something small. So we want to prove that this is small, and then we'll deduce that S has to be close to S equilibrium. And for this, we use loop equations. So we will bound all moments of these quantities by using loop equations. So what are loop equations? It's exact equations between moments here of the Stieglitz transform. It can be moments of other things in other contexts that are just obtained by integration by parts with respect to the Gibbs measure. So for example, for the one we are going to use, they appear in physics, for example, in this paper by Chekhov and Enar. And in the mass literature, there is a paper by Borot-Guionnet where they use this hierarchy of loop equations, but in terms of cumulants. And we use them in terms of moments instead of cumulants. Okay, so let me present these loop equations. That's where the technicalities appear. So, okay, the first one is really nice. For any z, which is actually, okay, I should not say, any z which is not real would be the not okay not, not only not in AB. For any z which is not real, we have that the expectation of this polynomial is equal to something in terms of s prime of z. So okay, how do you prove this? I said by integration by parts. How do you do an integration by parts here? You start from the expectation of s prime. So that's just the definition. You differentiate the S, you get this. And here you say that this quantity can be seen as the derivative, but now in terms of lambda, of 1 over lambda k minus z. And here you have to remember that your expectation is just an integral against the Gibbs measure. So in this integral, you do an integration by parts. So you integrate by part this, and you will have to differentiate exponential minus beta the Hamiltonian. And by differentiating this, you will have many terms that will appear. And these terms are everything else in this equation. Okay, that's it. Okay, so there is really nothing more than an integration by part and then calculations. Okay, you can do the same, but now with what we call spectator variables. So you fix other points. So you still have this z, and now you fix other points, z1 to zn. And you add a product of the Stieltjes transform at other points. Then you get a similar formula. So here, these two terms are really the same as these ones. You just have the spectator variables that are here and here. And the last term, okay, there are some interactions. And okay, it looks a bit more complicated. You still have the product of almost all spectator variables except one. And then you have this derivative with respect to the last spectator variable. Okay, so how do we use these equations? The idea, which was inspired by a paper of Lee and Schnelli, where actually it's for Wigner matrices, but they have nice formulas when they look at this moment, the moments of this polynomial. So the idea was, okay, maybe trying to get a formula for these moments instead of these quantities will be nicer. So, okay, we take the 2q moments of this quantity. We write it as once this polynomial and then everything else. This black thing here is this thing. So, okay, I have not said what everything here was, but I will take all the zi's that are either z or the conjugate of z. And because of this, I don't write the dependence. S is just S of z, but I don't write the dependence anymore. So this thing is exactly this. And this, you can expand the product, and you will get many products like this. And so to each term, you can apply this formula, and then combine again. And here is what you get. So, okay, it's not... It's nice, but maybe not so easy to see why it's nice. So, for example, you see here the spectator variables are not affected at all. So you get exactly the same thing as here in blue. And here, okay, you have to work a little bit to just see that that's what you get. Okay, so I'll comment more on this formula on the next slide. So, okay. Here is the same formula again. So the good thing on this in this formula is that now you have the 2q moment of your quantity, which is expressed in terms of smaller moments. Here, everything in blue are moments of order 2q minus 1 or 2q minus 2 of the same quantity. And then the things in black that are good, and I will explain why they are good. So the first thing we do is we apply Young's inequality. You can split each moment to write this as, for example, this one. You can write it as this to the 2q plus this to the 2q, but times a small constant, let's say 1/8. And so you will be able to integrate it on the other side. So you can just get rid of all the blue things and integrate them back on the other side. And you just get this inequality. So only a bound in terms of everything that was in black here. And why is it good? Because here, that's the second order quantity that we want to estimate. This is roughly S minus S equilibrium. And here you get a bound in terms of only things that are first order quantity. S prime is not recentered by S equilibrium prime, S second. It's just here it's the first order of each thing that appear, and here it's the second order. So everything will work fine, and at least in the bulk, it's really true that you can bound S minus S equilibrium by this polynomial. So if this polynomial is small, then S is really close of S equilibrium. So okay, here you just have to estimate the first order of all these quantities. The second order, you can all of integrate all of them to the left again, and you get actually exactly this one. Okay, I let you some time to ask a question if you want.
Maybe if you could comment on the power n to the 1 over 2 q on its origin.
Oh, this one?
Yes.
Okay. So here it's about applying Young's inequality. So Young's inequality tells you if you have a, it's a deterministic inequality, you have two numbers, x and y, that are positive. X times y is smaller than x to the a plus y to the b, so x to the a over a and plus y to the b over b, where a and b are conjugate, so 1 over a plus 1 over b is equal to 1. So more or less you can hear what we do, we say all this, the 1 over n, this constant and s prime, we raise them to the 2q, and then the conjugates will be 2q over 2q minus 1, which will exactly bring this to the power 2q. So we will get that this can be bounded by this, so everything here raised to the power 2q, plus this raised to, so which will be exactly a term like this. Okay.
Okay, thank you.
And just to finish on this, the small trick is to say instead of applying it to this and this, you put a small constant here, 1 over 10. And so you will get a 1 over 10. Here on the right-hand side, you will get this moment, but times 1 over 10. So you can put it on the left afterwards and say, it's fine. I can still bound this in terms of everything else because I just get smaller quantities on the right. Okay. Of course there are many terms and so on, but really I'm hiding nothing here. Okay. You have to compute the loop equations, but then I would say it's a one-page proof for Gaussian beta ensembles. Okay. So for general V. For general V, it's not so easy actually. There is an additional term in the loop equations, which just disappear when V is quadratic. And for this additional term, because of this additional term, if you try to do the same thing, it will not be self-consistent. Here, the thing which is really nice is that everything here depends on S. So once you know that this is related to S minus S equilibrium, you really have a self-consistent thing. You can say, okay, you need no input and that's it. You just get everything directly at one point by working only at one point without any multi-scale argument or whatever. But here you have this term that you cannot bound without any input. But okay, the good news is that this term is supposed to be smaller than everything else. Actually it requires more work to deal with this term than to do everything else. So, but it works. Okay, I won't say more about this. Okay, that's it for the local law. So back to less technical stuff. So now I want to talk about the central limit theorem. So as I said, an initial motivation was the fluctuation really of particles' positions. But one way to do it is to study the logarithm of the characteristic polynomial. So that's what we do. So the logarithm of the characteristic polynomial, you can write it as the sum over particles of the logarithm of e, e is just my variable, actually, minus lambda k. So it's a function of e. My logarithm here is the principal branch of the log, but extended to the negative axis. So on the negative axis, this is equal to I pi. Okay, here. So what do you get? If you take the real part of this, you get the sum of the log of the absolute value of e minus lambda k. This quantity is interesting actually in itself because it's the electric potential. So it's if you are at point E and you look at all logarithmic interaction with the system, you get this, actually, the sum over all particles of the logarithm of E minus lambda k. And the imaginary part, which is probably the thing which is the most interesting, it's just a counting function because the logarithm on the real line is just a step, which is equal to pi on the negative real line and zero afterwards. So you get this counting function of particles. That's how we get fluctuations for particle positions afterwards. Just by the imaginary part gives information about positions of particles. Okay, so the goal is to study the asymptotic behavior of these quantities. If you just plug in these quantities, the plot will be really deterministic because actually that's the law of large number here that plays a role. So we first have to remove the law of large numbers. So actually the random function that we are considering is a function of E, which is the logarithm of the characteristic polynomial recentered by this integral. Okay. In this case, we get these plots. So for the real part, you can see that there are many singularities at each particle. So here, that's really the plot where everything is plotted. But actually, we don't see the singularities. Maybe you could, if you see that, you could say it's not symmetric at all. There will never be a central limit theorem for this quantity. If you just discretize, I don't know, by 1 over n or a bit more than 1 over n, you won't see the singularities at all. It means that at the even at the microscopic scale, we cannot see the singularities. We can hope to have a central limit theorem for both these quantities, and that's the goal. Okay. So some more motivation about this is the framework of log-correlated fields. So the conjecture is that not only there are these quantities are Gaussian at one point, but that the correlation between two points will be logarithmic. So typically what you expect both for the real part and the imaginary part, at least in the bulk, what I'm writing here, is that the correlation between the field at point X and the field at point Y will be proportional to, there is this 1 over beta, but then proportional to the logarithm of the distance between X and Y. With a saturation effect at scale 1 over n, just because that's the microscopic scale in the bulk. So nothing happened below the scale 1 over n. Okay, this logarithmic correlation means that there is a really slow decay of correlations. There are equal contribution of correlations at all scales between 1 over n, the microscopic scale, and 1, the macroscopic scale. That's what it means. Okay. So there is a whole theory about log correlated fields. So just very, very quickly, there are other log correlated fields. First, you can just look at really Gaussian fields, such as the Gaussian free field in dimension 2, which is log correlated. There is branching Brownian motion, which is a bit toy model for this family of models. There is the logarithm of the Riemann zeta function on the critical axis, which is maybe not so surprising if you know that, of course, the Riemann zeta function has a lot to do with the characteristic polynomial of random matrices, and also cover time in dimension 2. Okay, and for all of these models, so that's just a kind of a parenthesis here, I won't come back to this, but there are many questions, and of course, these are the natural questions to ask when this question will be. So that's the question we answer here, but there are other questions which are, what is the behavior of the maximum of the field? This should be universal. And also, if you take the exponential of your field, renormalized, you define a measure, this measure should converge to the Gaussian multiplicative chaos. So this is more or less the first step to identify the log correlated behavior, but this requires much more work actually. Okay. So now, before presenting the result, one last thing is that okay, what is this quantity here? It's just a linear statistic, and so I just want to recall what are the results about central limit theorem for linear statistics. So linear statistics is just a sum of any function evaluated at each particle. This linear statistics, there is a for beta ensemble, it has been proved by Johansson in 98. The linear statistic, recentered by the law of large numbers, converges in law to some Gaussian random variable. So the first thing to note here, of course, is that you don't have to renormalize by square root n. It's really at order one, the fluctuations here. And then the limit, so there is this mean, which is explicit, but I won't write it. And the variance is given by this formula, which looks a bit ugly, but there are two reasons, okay, which makes the formula interesting. So first, you can see here in this formula that it does not depend on V. Okay, it's probably ugly, but it depends only on A and B. That's a kind of scaling, but that's it. Does not depend on V, that's already for free. And the second thing is that this large thing behaves actually as when S and T are close to each other, it behaves as the logarithm of the distance. So you already see the logarithmically correlated structure in this theorem by Johansson. So there are many results in random matrix theory about fluctuations of eigenvalues, of linear statistics, also in the mesoscopic scale. I won't review all of them. So mesoscopic scale means you take a smooth function again, but you scale it so that it varies at scale n to the minus s for any s between 0 and 1. And you still get a similar result. So for beta ensemble, this has been done by Beckermann-Lodia and then in another way by London Sosoyao. Our case is not the smooth case and not the mesoscopic scale. It's a case where f is really singular. So in two different ways, if you look at the real part of the log, you get log of absolute value of e minus lambda. And if you look at the real part of the imaginary part, you get these step functions. So in the two cases, what we want to do is just prove a central limit theorem for a linear statistic, but for a singular function. Okay. If you believe that this is still true, you can just plug in f in this, but you will get plus infinity actually. So how to do you get the truth? The idea is here, okay, this blows up because of this log singularity, but okay, you can believe that nothing is supposed to happen below the microscopic scale, which is 1 over n. So you can regularize f at scale 1 over n any way you want. If you regularize f at scale 1 over n, and now then you plug in into sigma square of f, you will get the truth, which is that actually sigma square of f is of order log n. So this means that for these particular functions, we have to renormalize to get the central limit theorem. We have to renormalize by 1 over square root log n. So finally, here is the results. So, okay, I remind you the definition of the thing we are considering. So this the log characteristic polynomial recentered by the law of large numbers. That's what we expect. So log correlation. You can see here that indeed, if your two points are the same, you will get this behavior, which is of order log n for the variance. So we renormalize by square root log n, also square root of beta, which is the beta which is here. And it will converge in law. So here I take the real part at two different points. It converges in law to Gaussian random variable. The variance is 1. And the covariance is given by alpha, where okay, alpha is defined by this, but more or less if E1 minus E2 are at distance n to the alpha, n to the minus alpha, then the covariance will be alpha. And there is a saturation at 1 because okay, if alpha is larger than 1, it means that E1 and E2 are closer than the microscopic scale, so it's completely correlated. Okay, I see a question in the chat. You. Okay.
It may be a private message that was sent to all
Ah,
by mistake.
okay. Nothing to answer very well. So, okay, that's the okay, that's the result in the specific case of the real part, and that's inside the bulk. So I take E1 and E2 that are between A and B at a positive distance from A and B. And this is true. The same result is true if I take the imaginary part instead of the real part. The actual result, we take any number of points. And we take jointly the real part and the imaginary part. The limit of the imaginary part is completely independent of the real part. There are no correlations between them. And then for the real part, you just get this, but with any number of points, and same for the imaginary part. Okay. That's true in the bulk. And then close to the edge, won't write precisely, but okay, we really have a result which writes everything up to the edge. But okay, I won't write it precisely. There are two interesting things to say. First, the real part and the imaginary part are still behaving independently, but they don't have the same behavior anymore. So for the real part, I would say it's easy to. Not to guess because it's not so easy to see at the first sight why it's not true for the imaginary part, but why the behavior changes just by changing this saturation. Here the saturation was at level 1 over n, which is the microscopic distance. But when you get close to the edge, the microscopic scale increases, and you just have to replace this by the microscopic scale where you are looking at. And it will get the theorem, give the theorem more or less. Okay. For the imaginary part, it's different. So the variance and the correlations are weaker than in the real part. So in particular, exactly at the edge, so the variance here for the real part will be 2/3 because the typical scale is n to the minus 2/3. But for the imaginary part, it will be 0. And this should not be a surprise as well, because at the edge, I remind you that the imaginary part is counting particles, so it's telling you about fluctuations of positions of particles. And we know that fluctuations of particles are not Gaussian at the edge, they are given by Tracy Whedon. So you could not expect to have a central limit theorem exactly at the edge. What happens instead is just that, okay, this log n is just killing everything and you get zero as a limit and you don't see the Tracy Whedon. Okay, questions about the statement? So as a consequence, we get the fluctuations of particles' locations. So I remind you that the imaginary part of the log characteristic polynomial is this counting function of particles. So if I call gamma k the position where you expect the kth particle to be, so it's given by the kth quantile, quantile of the equilibrium measure, then the fluctuation of lambda k around this position gamma k are of order square root log n over n, so you rescale by n over square root log n, at least in the bulk, then you have this normalization, which is the density, the equilibrium density at gamma k. So typically this is of order 1 in the bulk, but close to the edge it gets smaller and smaller, and it means that the fluctuations are larger and larger. This quantity satisfies exactly the same CLT, that's a almost deterministic result, as this one. So, okay, for free, we deduce a joint convergence result for these quantities. Fluctuations of particles are log correlated as well. And yeah, we get exactly the same result, but for this quantity. Okay, so maybe I will go a bit fast about the related works. So there are a bit two worlds. There is the world of integrable models, where a lot is known. So typically, for example, random unitary metrics, where there are many tools, and also GUE, which is a determinantal. So yeah, there are the families of models which are, say, integrable and where there are many results. And even, so I won't say more about this, but there are even convergence to Gaussian multiplicative chaos, which is stronger than this central limit theorem for the log characteristic polynomial. So many things are known in these cases. In the case of more general models, so of course, the most natural general model will be Vigneault matrices. Results are known. So first, there is a result by Tao and Wu under the four moments matching condition. And then it has been relaxed by Bourgade and Modi. So which, well, let's say if you know something for GOE and GUE, you can extend it to Vigneault matrices. Then, there is the case of circular beta ensembles, which are the generalization of classical groups to any temperature. There are partial results in this case. So result by Killip for the fluctuation of number of particles in an interval. And there are results by Gauthier-Lambert about the kind of central limit theorem, but with some regularization which is needed. Okay, and then the case which is probably the closest one to the one covered in this talk is the one of Gaussian beta ensembles, so the case of quadratic potential. There have been some progress recently. Lambert and Paquette proved in particular that the fluctuation for the real part of the log characteristic polynomial at the edge, and Augery, Butte, and Zaitouni proved it for any point in the bulk. And their methods are completely different from ours. They use the fact that there is a tridiagonal structure for Gaussian beta ensembles, and so you get a recursion for the characteristic polynomial from this, and they study this recurrence. And okay, that's So it works for other tri-diagonal models, actually. Okay, for us, how do we prove the results? We use again loop equations, actually. But we need the optimal law as an input. So here, the method we use is it's a classical method using loop equation, even more or less the one that Johansson used. But we have this new local law as input, so we can bound everything in a much more precise way. So one interest of this result is also that okay shows that we can get a central limit theorem for singular linear statistics using only loop equations, because both the local law and then the rest of the proof relies on loop equations. Sorry, I don't know what happened. I'm on a good connection, but okay. Do you still hear me?
Yes, we can hear you and we see your slides.
Okay, very good. Okay, it's almost time, so I will just mention briefly the proof of the CLT and then stop before I'm stopped again by the connection. So there are mainly two steps in this proof. As I said, the Johansson's theorem, the CLT by Johansson, has to be true once the function is regularized. So the first step is just to regularize the function. So how do we do that? We replace the logarithm at e by the logarithm at e plus I eta, with eta which is slightly more, okay, here it doesn't matter so much, but slightly more than the microscopic scale. Okay, I won't say much more about the method, but more or less it relies here. We use the optimal local law, and we have to get a bound on the. We have to prove that in any submicroscopic interval, there are no particles with high priority. So that's this part, which is actually not. I would say the only part which is not really relying on it seems obvious, but it's not relying on loop equations. Okay, so then we have to prove the central limit theorem, but now with this regularized function. And for this, we follow the method by Johansson. So what is this method briefly? So Sn of f is my centered linear statistic. I look at the Laplace transform of this linear statistic, and I want to estimate the Laplace transform to prove the convergence. And for this, the idea is to use a change of measure. You change your measure by this exponential t times your linear statistics. And if you want, your new measure is still nice because this just means that you modified the potential by f. You add in the potential, you can include this term here inside the potential and just say, I changed my potential. And then what we estimate is actually the derivative of the Laplace transform, because the derivative of the Laplace transform of divided by the Laplace transform is equal to the expectation under the new measure of Sn of f. So the bad thing is that we have to work under this modified measure, but the good thing is that we are only computing a first moment, which is much nicer than this exponential. Okay, and to compute this first moment, we use Helfer-Jastrom formula. We can represent f, any function f, as an integral on the complex plane of some function g, which is defined in terms of f times 1 over x minus w. And the good thing is that the Stieltjes transform appears. And we have tools to study the Stieltjes transform. So then we just have to estimate this. And that's the point where we use loop equations again. Okay, so I won't say a lot about it, but we use the first loop equation, but now under the modified measure. So there is an additional term, which is this one, because f is in the potential now. And we use the fact that we have the local law as input to precisely estimate the leading order terms in this loop equation and to get a precise estimate for this quantity. If we have a precise estimate for this quantity, we can estimate this. So we can estimate z prime over z, and we can integrate, and we find the Laplace transform. That's really more or less the idea of the initial idea of Johansson. Just we have better inputs. Okay, that's it. I'll stop here. Okay.
Thank you, Michel. Are there questions? Ah, now we see you again.
Yes, I let it off because I was afraid to be disconnected
yeah,
again
I
with the
think
camera.
It was probably... I maybe have a question related to the beginning of your talk. This constant C of Q that appears in the optimal local law, how does it grow? How does it grow with Q?
So, okay, in the proof here, we have seen this. So if so here it's 2q. So if you want, the q's moment will be cq to the q over 2. And that's only in the bulk. That's why I don't write it in the theorem, is because it depends a bit on the region. But okay, more than in the bulk, everywhere there is a kind of trapezoid region where you have really good estimate for S minus S equilibrium in terms of this polynomial, up to the edge, but not past the edge, let's say. We have this constant. And why is it really good? Because Q to the Q over 2, for moments, it means that you are Gaussian, actually. You have a Gaussian tail. So, yeah. That's probably optimal, I think, this one. And then past the edge, we have suboptimal constants.
Question. So the off-critical assumption.
Yes.
A priori, you don't need it because your result is the fluctuation is related to the fluctuations of the eigenvalues within the bulk, and the off-critical assumption is concerns the edge, right?
Yes. So. No. The fluctuation result actually holds up to the edge. I stated it in the bulk, but. Okay, we have a statement up to the edge. Indeed, if we only want the local law only in the bulk, and we only want the fluctuations in the bulk, there is this additional term where probably if the potential is critical, there would be something annoying, but probably we can deal with it. Otherwise, I think it works, yes. But okay, actually, a kind of advertisement. We are trying to extend this up to the edge for these methods to critical ensembles. But of course, close to the edge, there are many, many issues. But...
Okay. And a second question. In your slide 15,
yes.
Is it obvious to get the fluctuations for lambda k from the fluctuation from imaginary part of the linear statistics?
Yes. So okay, obvious. It depends. It's a one line proof. It's one line if you write really small. What's the idea? You look at the probability. The idea is look at the probability that this is larger than some x. Let's say some a, because x is here. Some a. You want to prove that the tail converges to the tail of the Gaussian. So you look at the probability that this is larger than A. You put everything else on the other side, so you get lambda k minus gamma k, probability that lambda k minus gamma k is larger than something. Okay. So it means probability that lambda k is larger than gamma k plus something. This means that the if lambda k is larger than this, okay, there is one step where you have to be careful. If you know that lambda k is larger than something, it means that this function is larger than something as well, or smaller than something as well. Okay, it's hard to do in my mind, sorry. But that's really, there is a deterministic thing, and that's a deterministic result. I mean, if this is larger than something, you can deduce that this has to be larger or smaller than something. I'm too tired to find it exactly, but that's you have this deterministic correspondence, and then you just have to estimate things. But really here that's there is nothing hidden here. That's really an easy consequence.
I have another question related to the one I asked before. Does it make sense to look at the supremum over Z of S of Z minus S equilibrium and try to understand the distribution if you scale it?
The maximum over Z along an horizontal line, you mean? Or?
Yes. I was wondering if it was so you said that the moments they have Gaussian tails, and I was wondering if one can say something even more precise that that the maximum over Z has some distribution.
Okay, really, I don't know. Okay, no, I've never thought about that for the Stieltjes transform. It's probably not just a Gaussian Gaussian random variable about, divided by eta. It's probably larger. I mean, there are probably points where it's probably one order larger. I don't know what, but square root log n or whatever. Okay, I really don't know, but
Are there other questions? So, if not, let's thank Michel again.
Thank you.